Tonight, Loic Wacan will deliver the Rote Simons Lecture, the ninth in the series that was funded in 2000 by W. Mason Smith of the class of 1965. Mr. Smith is with us tonight in the audience, which is very nice to have him here. Previous Rote Simons lecturers have been the sociologist Richard Sennett and Seth Lowe, the architect, legislator, and diplomat Richard Sweat, the anthropologist Arjun Appadurai, the philosopher Richard Kuhns, and the social critic and technologist Stephen Johnson. Last year's lecturer was sociologist Adrian Favell. The Rote Simons lectures are named for two of Mr. Smith's classmates at Yale School of Architecture. One of them, Rob Simons, died during the summer after his second year at our school as a result of a freak accident caused by lightning. The other, David Rote, a successful architect practicing in New York, where he specialized in affordable housing, was killed in 1995 when a gunman went berserk in the elevator of his office building. The purpose of the Rote Simons Lecture Series is to bring before the school, a lecturer whose work and ideas can help us open ourselves to a wide range of social and ethical issues that necessarily affect professional practice. Tonight's Rote Simons Lecture is the keynote to tomorrow's symposium, Spatial Illiteracies. That symposium was organized by Eben Falconer and Olga Pantelidou, second-year students in our MED program of advanced research. Spatial illiteracies will afford us all of an opportunity to hear the latest, freshest thinking from advanced graduate students in other universities who are tackling in their dissertations the impact that expanded literacy and expanded public access to information in general, upward social mobility, and democratization are having on the interplay between space and communication. That's only a brief summary of the breadth of the topics and the thrust of the discussion slated for tomorrow morning and afternoon. Loic Wacan is professor of sociology and research associate at the Institute for Legal Research at the Bolt Law School of the University of California at Berkeley, where he is also affiliated with the program in medical anthropology, the Global Metropolitan Studies Program, and the Center for Urban Ethnography. Additionally, Professor Wacan is a researcher at the Centre de Sociologie Européenne in Paris. Professor Wacan was educated in France and at the University of Chicago, where he earned his PhD in sociology in 1993, after having pursued graduate studies in industrial economics. A MacArthur Foundation Fellow from 1997 to 2002, he has taught at various universities and is the author of numerous scholarly articles, as well as several influential books, including Prisons of Poverty, published in 1999, Body and Soul, Ethnographic Notebooks of an Apprentice Boxer, published in 2000. Most recently, he has published Deadly Symbiosis, Race and the Rise of Neoliberal Penality, published in, I believe, in 2007. Professor Wacan's interests, especially his studies of inequality and marginality, ethno-racial domination, carceral institutions, and penal policies as instruments for managing dispossessed and dishonored groups, make him an ideal person to set the stage for tomorrow's symposium and for stimulating us tonight. Please join me in welcoming Professor Loic Wacan as the ninth Rote Simons Lecturer.
Thank you very much for this generous welcome, which reminds me of the disadvantages of being in a department where your web page is not updated. So people read a presentation of your work that is sort of 2 years old or 3 years old and contains many information that are inaccurate, but that I have to bear the responsibility for that. It's It's an honor and a pleasure to be invited to give this lecture and to have, in a sense, my work noted and engaged by scholars in architecture. It's actually the third invitation that I get this year from architecture urban planning schools in the United States suddenly, and I take it that perhaps the recent publication of the book that's not listed on my webpage, but is the most recently published book, is Urban Outcasts, A Comparative Sociology of Advanced Marginality, might be the reason why the work has attracted the attention of colleagues in architecture and urban planning. It's a double pleasure, since I was raised in intellectual tradition, the European one, with very low disciplinary threshold, and so I consider myself not a sociologist, but rather a social scientist who happened to be in a sociology department. And I consider as part of my general duty to engage issues across disciplinary boundaries, and including across the boundary between the sort of scholarly crafts and the more professional crafts. So it's a pleasure to be here, and I think that the issue of urban marginality lends itself to these exchanges across disciplines and across schools. At the same time, it's a bit daunting because, and I'm not one who's easily intimidated, because it's sort of hard to sense the concerns and the interest, the expectations of the audience from a field from which one is quite remote. But what I'm going to try to do is basically sort of bring you external stimulation on an issue in which I've spent about a decade working, which is the issue of the changing forms of urban marginality in advanced societies, or what I called urban polarization from below. And what I propose to do is to give you a sort of analytic, synoptic linkage between my two most recent books. The first one, Urban Outcasts, that looks at the transformation of the Black American ghetto since the wave of riots of the 1960s, and asks and answers the question, what happened to that particular urban socio-spatial constellation in the American metropolis in the three decades since the riots of the 60s. And then the second question that the book asks is then, what can we learn from the comparison of the evolution of the Black American ghetto over these three decades with the, so this is here, the G is the ghetto. And then what happens when we compare and contrast the transformation of the Black American ghetto over three decades with the transformation of Europeans' working class territory, the WCT, that you have immediately identified right here. And so what can we learn when we do these comparisons? And typically, there's been very little comparative work of this kind done. I can actually even say that one of the impetus for publishing the book at long last, after sort of 10 years, is that there was no other book of comparative urban marginality of this kind. And the comparison teaches us that the convergence thesis, the idea that there's been a sort of epochal shift that has led to the Americanization of forms of urban poverty in the European urban periphery, with the rise of salience of ethnicity, the concentration of poverty, the growing segregation, and the growing violence and dilapidation of lower class districts in the era of deindustrialization in Western Europe. There's been generally this perception that this signals the Americanization of the European city and the sort of global convergence on the American pattern of urban marginality. And what I demonstrate in Urban Outcasts is that this convergence thesis is wrong. It's wrong because it's based on a wrong diagnosis of what constitutes a ghetto and what happened to the ghetto after the 1960s. And it's wrong because also it mischaracterizes what is a working class territory and mischaracterizes this evolution. Here I argue that the ghetto has become transformed. It hasn't simply stayed and become poorer or become more destitute or become more violent, but rather the ghetto, after the riots of the 60s, collapse, it implodes, and it leads to the creation of the emergence of a new form, a new urban form, which I call the hyperghetto. Whereas in Europe, I find that the working class territory, far from becoming more like an American ghetto, in fact moves away from the pattern of the ghetto properly conceptualized, leading to what I call, by provocation, an anti-ghetto. And so this is basically the first volume, it's the Urban Outcast. And so I'm giving you the overall path of my reasoning, and then I'm going to go through the whole diagram in little bit more detail and hopefully leave enough time for the discussion, because for me, the more interest, I already know what I have to say, although you always discover new things when you, especially when you try to present them in sort of graphical form in this fashion. But I will, you know, learn more from the discussion. Also, many of the things that I can say sort of ex cathedra in my presentation here, I can say perhaps even in a more convincing way as a response to a question. So, but let me just walk you through quickly through this. And so I refute the thesis of convergence, and I argue for the emergence of a new regime of urban marginality. And I spend two chapters characterizing this new regime of urban marginality that, if you wish, supersedes, replaces, overlays both the imploding ghetto that has led to the creation of the hyperghetto in the American metropolis, and overlays, supersedes the working class territory that has led to the emergence of what we can characterize as anti-ghettos in Western Europe. And I spend two chapters, one providing a sort of synchronic slice of what this new regime of urban marginality is, and I give six distinctive properties, one of which only I will highlight today is the property of territorial stigmatization. TS, of course, everybody knows that. And then I spend another chapter, instead of looking synchronically at what does advanced marginality look like if you sort of take a slice at a given time and try to sort of anatomize it, but rather I take a diachronic look at what are the forces that are propelling it, that are making it a form of marginality that I call advanced marginality, because it's not a marginality that's a holdover from a bygone era. It's not a leftover from the industrial Fordist Keynesian era. It's not also a cyclical or a transitional phenomenon, but rather these are forms of urban poverty that are deeply entrenched, and in fact that are nourished not by the backwards sectors of the economy, but rather by the more advanced sectors of the economy. Thus, the name that I give it, I call it advanced marginality. Oh, I forgot to put that. Advanced marginality here. And so, and then, so I highlight six properties, and then I four dynamics that fuel it. And so that takes us from the realm of empirical observation when we are querying, well, what happens to these two socio-spatial constellations when we observe their evolution, which leads to an effort to theorize the emergence of this new regime of urban marginality. And then in the second book, so that's in a sense diagnosing the fate of the Black American ghetto, the fate of the European working class territory, their continued divergence, but the fact that they both become the territory in which, if we're going to speak of a new social condition, I argue what is emerging in both of these territories, they're not simply the sinkholes of a bygone era, but rather they are the incubator of a new population and putative group. But I'll argue that, in fact, one of the impact of territorial stigmatization is to make the coalescing of this population into a group capable of acting as a collective on the stage of history impossible, is the precariat. And by precariat, I mean the precarious fractions of the proletariat. You compress, it gives you the precariat, which I characterize as those precarious, those fractions of the new post-industrial working class that are, in a sense, in a permanently unstable, insecure position due to, on the one side, the deregulation of the labor market and the growth of insecure wage work, but also due to the press of stigmatization. And stigmatization can take a variety of forms. It can be ethnic stigmatization, it can be a post-colonial migrant stigmatization, or it can be territorial stigmatization. Being from a particular neighborhood, from a particular place, identify as an urban hellhole in which only the rejects of society would tolerate living, and therefore has an impact over and beyond the stigma of poverty or the stigma of ethnicity or the stigma attached to post-colonial migration. And that of course raises the question, once you have made this diagnosis, what were the reactions of the US states? What were the reactions of the political elites of the states on both sides of the Atlantic to the collapse of the Black American ghetto on the one side, to the erosion of the working class territory on the other side, to the emergence of this new regime of advanced urban marginality? And here, this takes us to the second volume. So this one is not on my webpage, but actually it is now on the updated version. But this one is already available, Urban Outcast. Volume two, in a sense, is what is the policy innovation that sought to react to the rise of urban marginality and try to contain it in particular. And it's called Punishing the Poor,
the neoliberal government of social insecurity, and it's coming out in 6 weeks with Duke University Press. And in this book, I look so at the policy reaction to the emergence of advanced marginality. And I show in the preface of the book that when governments face undesirable conduct or conditions, they have three basic techniques that they can use to sort of treat the ills that they face. One is to socialize it, the second is to medicalize it, and the third is to penalize it. Let's take, for the example, homelessness, a condition that architects should be concerned about since they're in the business of building structures, many of which serve to house people. You walk out of, I don't know about the campus of Yale, but on the campus of Berkeley, there are many homeless people right on campus, right at the doorsteps of the buildings. When you see a homeless person, you can react by saying, we will treat that condition by treating the social mechanisms that are producing that condition, such as we will build low-income housing, or we will provide income support such that persons without houses can avail themselves housing on the rental market. That's called, in a sense, the socializing treatment. You could medicalize it by arguing that this person is derelict, sleeping in front of Barrows Hall, the sociology department, one of the most architecturally ugly buildings on the UC campus where I teach. And you can say, well, this person is homeless because they suffer from mental illness. They are incapable of functioning, of holding a job, of leading a regular life. They find themselves on the street, and therefore they're in need of psychiatric care, of medical attention, and so you medicalize the condition. Or you can use the third form of treatment, which is the penalization. You can say, well, it's illegal to sleep outside, to sleep on the floor, to sleep in the building, or you can pass an ordinance, as many cities have done. It's illegal to panhandle, to sleep in public parks, and you send the police and you arrest the homeless person who instantly disappears as a homeless person because now she's or he is an inmate in a jail facility who eventually cycles in and commits enough small offenses so that they ratchet up a record and they eventually get a felony sanction and they get sent in the prison system. And there you have the rise of, in a sense, so my argument is that the particular combination of these three treatments, socializing, medicalizing, penalizing, and the particular conditions to which they are directed, depends, in a sense, on the balance of power of the various groups, professions, interests that push for, in a sense, targeting certain conditions as undesirable, unacceptable, necessitating the intervention of the state, and then also battle to determine the particular combination of those three possible treatments. And my argument in punishing the poor is that in advanced societies, in the last three decades in the United States, in the last decade in Western Europe, there's been a tendency to move from the social treatment of urban marginality to the penal treatment of marginality, and to handle, in a sense, the population marginalized by the transmission of the labor market, by the transmission of the welfare state, to handle that population, that derelict population caught in the throes of urban marginality, by applying the penal treatment, and then by applying the penal treatment, that is, by rolling out the police, the courts, and the prison system as a way of curbing, containing the urban disorders created at the bottom of the class structure, at the bottom of the system of places as well, that is, the hierarchy of neighborhoods, by rolling out the penal apparatus as a means to curb and control these disorders, as a means of neutralizing the more disruptive members of this marginalized population, and also as a means of reasserting the legitimacy, reasserting the fortitude of the rulers and shoring up the deficit of legitimacy that political elites suffer everywhere when they roll back the traditional missions of economic and social protection of the state. Of course, the rolling out of the penal state. Thus, the United States, which in 1973 was supposed to show the world the way to a society without a prison. In 1975, a famous edited volume by some of the best specialists of the penal question in the United States published a volume called A Society Without a Prison, where it was believed that the United States was on the cusp of showing the rest of the world how to create a technologically advanced, economically sophisticated society that would get rid of the prison entirely. At that time, the US had just undergone a period of 15 years of declining prison population, even though the crime rate was rising. This was in 1973, when the curve of imprisonment in the United States reached its nadir. After that period, the United States doubled its prison population every 10 years, three times, leading to going from 380,000 inmates to 2.3 million inmates, becoming world leader in incarceration. So the building of a massive penal state in the United States was a response not to rising criminal insecurity, but rather to rising social insecurity that has fed the urban marginality that has to be handled by one way or another. And the rise of the penal state was a response to the rise of urban marginality. So this is, in a sense, this is the schema that I'm gonna sort of walk you through. And then what I wanted to sort of argue, to try to make an is to make a connection with the practice of architecture and urban planning, is I'm going to sketch this sort of analytic tale, a story of mechanisms, a story of processes, how they account for the changing forms of urban marginality and inequality at the dawn of our century, and what they imply for the built environment, and thus for the practice of architecture and urban planning. And what I'm going to do is, in a sense, I'm going to start by arguing that this is, in a sense, a particular specification of a broader issue. The broader issue, analytically for me, is the use of space as an instrument and a medium of power. And in a sense, what I'm looking at is one particular configuration of what we could call more broadly urban seclusion. It's urban seclusion, which is itself a subtype of socio-spatial seclusion, of which you have, in a sense, the rural variety and the urban variety. Now, seclusion, I would argue, is the process, so let me, in a sense, explain the title, and which takes us to this diagram, and then I'll locate urban seclusion, in particular, the relationship between the ghetto and the prison in this diagram, and then I'll walk you sort of analytically through this argument here, and then we can have some questions if you haven't understood every single sign on the two diagrams. I'll be happy to try to explain, if I can remember myself, what they are, because I made this drawing quickly as a sort of memory jogger for me, for the argument, so that I don't get lost. And so it may be that I come to step in, I come to a place in the diagram and I don't know, I don't remember what that's supposed to mean, but, you know. So seclusion. Seclusion is the process whereby populations and activities are confined, kept in, hemmed in, isolated in a particular quadrant of physical and social space. This comes from the verb to seclude, 1451, from secludere, which means to shut off, to confine. And so I argue that, in a sense, socio-spatial seclusion is the process whereby we confine particular activities or particular populations in a sort of reserved quadrant of physical space or social space. Urban seclusion, then, would be what? Seclusion in an urban environment, seclusion in a city. But we must not, you know, in a sense, so socio-spatial seclusion becomes specified in two dimensions, rural social spatial seclusion, if you wish, and urban socio-spatial seclusion. Urban, I would argue then, in the city, defined not by its size, its density, its heterogeneity in classic Chicago-style fashion with Louis Wirth, but rather the city as a locus of accumulation and accretion of various forms of capital, following Pierre Bourdieu. Economic capital, cultural capital, social capital, symbolic capital. And so we can think of forms of urban socio-spatial seclusion as being distributed along two dimensions. And I've put these two dimensions here in yellow here. Seclusion at the top, seclusion at the bottom. Bottom of the, you can make it the class order, you can make it the ethnic order, you can make it the order of the prestige of places. Typically, these are so tightly correlated that, in a sense, it doesn't really fundamentally change the diagram. So you can have seclusion at the top and seclusion at the bottom of society. And then you can have seclusion that is chosen, that is elective, that is the result of affinity and the desire to participate into that space or to limit oneself in that space. Or you can have seclusion as a result of constraint, as a result of being forced by external powers to limit your activities, limit your presence, your residence in a particular location. And so here, in a sense, we have affinity as affinity and typically power as a principle of socio-spatial seclusion. And here we have, in a sense, hostility from without as the principle. And here I would then, we can distribute the typical forms of socio-spatial seclusion in that 2x2 space. And it gives us, if you wish, sort of a 2x2 table or a two-dimensional space. Elective versus forced, at the top versus the bottom. Elective versus forced, so you have those who choose to be secluded, who desire shelter, who seek privacy, who appreciate isolation, who want to be among the likes of themselves. This is triggered by affinity, by in-group orientation. This is perfectly represented by the elite, upper-class enclaves, but even more so, in a sense, in a hyperbolic form, by the gated communities, where people at the top choose to isolate, to create a physical boundaries with an actual gate and lock and guards to ensure social homogeneity, protection from crime, protection from the presence of undesirable groups and activities. And then at the, so noble at the top of the class order, ethnic hierarchy, the ranking of places, noble activities, powerful, prestigious categories who possess the material and the symbolic capital to self-seclude and exclude others, and exclude in particular ignoble activities. So you have the noble at the top and the ignoble activities and groups at the bottom, the dispossessed and the dishonors. And this 2x2 table gives us at least the ability to understand in relationship to each other the creation of gated communities or elite enclaves, the antonym of which, I would argue, is the ghetto, as a particular socio-spatial device that is used to contain and control a stigmatized, subordinate ethno-racial or ethno-religious category from which economic value will be extracted, but which will be maintained in a separate living space so that they do not contaminate by their presence the rest of the city. And this is actually Richard Sennett, in his investigation of the fear of touching in 16th century Venice, the invention of the first ghetto, the ghetto of Venice, that gave this particular socio-spatial configuration its original name in 1516, calls the ghetto a very beautiful expression that I like to, particularly as you will see, imagine with particular pleasure to use with undergrads. It's called, he calls it an urban condom. Causing an urban condom that allows for the penetration of the Christian city by Jews who are necessary at the courts to provide a variety of financial and trade services to the princes that are now emerging in these municipalities as powers, but whose bodies must be isolated and secluded and not come, especially in intimate contact with others, because they are believed to be bearers not only of disease but of heresy. And so they must be brought into the city and the economic value that they provide extracted, but they must be socially ostracized. And so the ghetto emerges as a particular socio-spatial contraption, an urban condom, that allows penetration without actual physical contact, that allows to have economic extraction of the value provided uniquely by that stigmatized category, but to have social ostracization at the same time. And those are the two functions of a ghetto historically. Now, a little later on, if I have time, I'm going to get to the parallels between a ghetto and a prison and why we can not only locate, why it's useful to locate them in this quadrant of this theoretical space, because it helps us understand the structural and functional similarities between ghettos and prisons as institutions of forced and containment of in a way, the ghetto is an ethno-racial prison that allows for a particular tainted category population to be present in the city while being sort of contained, imprisoned in its separate life sphere. And the prison, conversely, is something of a judicial ghetto. It makes it possible to hold those who have been struck by a stigma, the stigma of criminal sanction, to be held, in a sense, inside the social body while not being in contact with other members of the population. Now, if I had to, I'm going to return to the argument in Urban Outcast through the route of this more abstract theoretical schema. But before I do so, let me put in, and that's sort of thinking about why do you, you know, what is urban? You know, I teach a course in urban sociology at Berkeley, the first thing I teach is there is no such thing as urban sociology. Okay, you know, why speak only of urban seclusion? Well, because architects generally don't build buildings for the countryside. They are animal, you know, they are urban animals themselves. So they sort of unquestionably assume that everything that's of interest is going on in the city. But urban seclusion is, in a sense, one particular specification in the urban environment of a broader process, socio-spatial seclusion, the use of space as a device for containing and controlling groups. But it can happen in a rural environment. It's actually very interesting to think of the contrast between the two. And there's many things to be learned about the dynamics of urban seclusion by contrasting it, if only briefly, to processes of socio-spatial seclusion in the rural environment. And so let me just say very briefly, if I had more time, if the Roth Simons lecture was a two-lecture series, I would spend a little bit of time speaking about how in the rural environment, typically, what determines whether you have an urban, now the getaway is by definition an urban animal. But if you are not bringing an undesirable category, a stigmatized population inside the city, typically you will hold them in a reservation. And in particular, if you don't want the labor of a particular group, but you want their land, you will remove them, you will use space as an instrument of power, you will exercise socio-spatial seclusion in the rural environment to capture their land, so they won't be coming into the city, and you will try to fix them in a rural location, where you retrieve the land, but you, in a sense, remove them from that land. And in a sense, that's the story of Native Americans in this country, is that what was desirable for them in the colonial project was not their labor power, but their land. And so socio-spatial seclusion was exercised against them in order to capture the valuable land. And so they were relocated in a reserved territory, the reservation. Then, of course, there's all the intermediate cases where you actually need the labor power, but you might need it in an environment where you would not want that population to urbanize. Why? Because as a population urbanizes, its cost of reproduction becomes higher. It seeps the boundaries that you are trying to maintain. And so you would like to be able to bring, for instance, labor power in an environment, but prevent that population from fully proletarizing and urbanizing. And this is typically where you get a camp. You get a camp that can be a labor camp, or that can be a refugee camp. And so here you get a whole constellation. And so there's many things to be learned about the formation of the ghetto, about the formation of the gated community, by contrasting it, in a sense, as the higher class, prestigious, noble self-seclusion of the powerful, by contrast with the forced, constrained, socio-spatial seclusion of the ignoble population at the bottom of the urban order, as well as by contrasting it, by contrasting the ghetto and the prison, with the formations of reservations and the formations of camps. So in a sense, this is the broader analytical space, socio-spatial seclusion, the rural variety, the urban variety, and then now we're going to go into what happened in the Black American ghetto in the 60s, depending on how much time. Not too bad, considering the amount of ground I've covered, thanks to this. Thanks to this socio-spatial device of the diagram. But for instance, to give you an idea of how, for instance, you can plug South Africa in this space, and you can look at the formation of the Bantustans, the mining compounds that serves to extract the labor in the era of the boom of the mining industry, the formation of the townships, which are the South African version of the ghetto. Their contrast with the ethnic clusters formed by the other ethnic categories inside of the South African city, and of course, the emergence of the elite enclaves and the reserve neighborhoods and the gated, protected, fortified communities, which under apartheid was exclusively white, but increasingly, in a sense, there's been the formation of black gated communities in Johannesburg. And in a sense, you can bring the various forms of socio-spatial seclusion present in a given social formation into one single analytical framework and sort of theorize them together instead of separating what is traditionally done. I mean, you know, traditionally, the normal sociologist would say, you know, well, this is rural sociology, or this is, you know, economic development, and so on. We don't need to, you know, if these people haven't come into the city, then it needs not concern us. And the typical urban sociologist will completely ignore that quadrant, in a sense, losing the analytical mileage that you can get if you see those as similar processes specified in different environments. But also, similarly, you have those who studied gated communities typically have shown no interest in ghettos and ethnic clusters and prisons. They think that, you know, gated communities are sort of a process in itself, simply at the top, and you can study them by, you know, and this actually is interesting because the studies of urban communities, gated communities have been done by two sort of species, two academic species, urban planners and anthropologists, you know, who, you know, in a sense, whose analytic focus is in a sense, is well made to isolate these gated communities from the broader space within they take their space, and then to go in now sort of, you know, in a down in level of abstraction, if you take this quadrant here, people who have studied ethnic clusters, and here in the United States, that would mean the social and spatial fate of European migrant streams, Irish Americans, Italians Americans, the white ethnics, that were said by the Chicago School to be living in ghettos, you know, and the Chicago School makes the cardinal mistake of collapsing into one and the same category, the ethnic clusters in which the Irish Americans, German Americans, Italian Americans live, and so on and so forth, which are largely the results of choice and affinity and are oriented towards the outside and are way stations towards the social and spatial integration of that group into the broader space of American society, made the cardinal mistake, and here Parkworth and so on and so forth, all my ancestors at Chicago are, you know, bear a great guilt. They make the cardinal mistake of confusing the ethnic cluster, which is a very structurally and functionally opposite type to the ghetto. The ghetto is not a device that is used to prepare the group for its assimilation and its entry to the broader society. It is an instrument to dissimulate. It is an instrument to keep the group, in a sense, forever separate. And so the ethnic cluster would be represented by a bridge in architectural term, if you wish. Whereas the ghetto would be represented by a wall. One is, you know, a machinery to lead you into the broader society and to help you fan across space, whereas the ghetto was never designed for that. And so typically, here again, people who study sort of, you know, migration study ethnic clusters, and they leave to students of African American history the study of the ghetto. And conversely, people who study the Black American ghetto, you know, rarely sort of branch out. Yes, there are a few comparisons and so on, but typically confusing the two socio-spatial formations. And now, going in, narrowing our frame, our analytic lens even further. Now, if we go into that little box, people who studied the ghetto never study prisons. And conversely, criminologists and penologists who studied the prison have never thought and have never sort of related the prison to the other form of coerced spatial containment that is observable in the city, the ghetto. And if they had, as I have done in my work, they would have realized the structural, and so here we have a structural and functional dissimilarity and opposition between the ethnic cluster and the ghetto. But inside of this quadrant, and this is why they are here, located almost, you know, in the same location in that 2x2 dimension, the prison and the ghetto are made up of the same elements. And in fact, since I won't have the time to return to this, let me give you those four elements, and then you're going to begin to see why it is that when the ghetto collapsed and gave way to the hyperghetto, and these forms of marginality, in a sense, threatened the social and the moral order in the cities in the United States in the 1980s and 90s, the response of the US state was to shrink the social welfare state, move from welfare as a right to be protected from the sanction of the market to workfare as a trampoline to prepare people to be submitted to the discipline of insecure wage work on the one hand, and coupled punitive and restrictive workfare with expensive and generous prison fare. Why? Because the prison, in a sense, offered itself as the simplex solution to deal with these disorders, because it presented the same structure and the same functional facility as the ghetto. Why? Because a ghetto is, we said, a socio-spatial formation that does two things. It allows the economic extraction of the value out of the group and to keep that group separate, living its own spheres and preventing in particular intimate contact. And it's composed of four elements. To make a ghetto takes four structural elements. The first one is stigma. You have to have a category that is stigmatized, that bears the taint for Jews, an ethno-religious stigma, for Jews in the in the ghetto of Renaissance Europe, in the 16th, 17th, 18th century Europe, for African Americans in the industrial Fordist metropolis between 1910 and 1970, the taint associated with slavery. So stigma is one. Second, it takes constraints. Those groups who become segregated or become confined out of the will to be confined, out of ethnic affinity, who regroup together, such as Little Italy or Little Island or Germantown, who want to be, in a sense, near co-ethnics, are in a diametrically opposed position to those who are constrained to live with the likes of their members of their own category because they don't have a choice. Second element, so stigma, constraints. So a ghetto is a particular socio-spatial configuration that emerges when a stigmatized population is constrained to live in a particular bounded, sharply bounded, clearly reserved area where the totality or the near totality of that population is forced to reside and where, of course, it creates not only the majority, but it creates, in a sense, an ethnically homogeneous population living in that reserved territory. So we have stigma, in fact, it is the missing formula. Let me put the formula here. Stigma, constraints, spatial confinement, and when that stigmatized population is constrained to live in that reserved territory, it will develop its own parallel institutions within that territory. And this is indeed what happens to the Jewish ghetto in Renaissance Europe. Jews, in a sense, create a shared collective identity, shared institutions, of religious institutions, economic institutions, institutions of mutual support, institutions of collective representations, and so on. And they create, in a sense, a parallel Jewish city inside of the Christian city. And what is the Black American ghetto? Similarly, a stigmatized population forced to reside in a separate, sharply bounded territory in which it will develop its own parallel institutions for African Americans, by African Americans, to, in a sense, fulfill the needs that are not fulfilled because of the exclusion from the broader institution. So what we have there is institutional parallelism, the creation of a black city within the white, which is the very definition in the absolutely great book that every, and I assume this being the top architecture program in the country, or one of the top, that every student in this room, of course, has read one of the best, one of the top 10 books of all times in all disciplines. And I'm not even talking about social sciences here. A book by Drake and Caton, Black Metropolis. No, I'm not saying that you're carrying that book with you because it's 800 pages and it sort of bulges out of your back pocket when you have it. But your Black Metropolis describes, in a sense, how African Americans were forced, because of the stigma bearing on them, to live in a separate territory where they didn't simply live in a separate territory, but they created a black city within the white, Bronzeville, that was a separate sphere that protected them. And importantly, a ghetto, so let me not erase Caton's name here, but you see how it's clarifying. I think the diagram is clearly becoming clearer. And here, this clues us to two functions of the ghetto that I think historians of the ghetto, anthropologists of the ghetto, sociologists of the ghetto have not understood well. And I have the arrogance to say that I think I have, is that a ghetto is an instrument of oppression. Yes, and in a sense, it's typically seen like that. But what people don't see is that also a ghetto is a shield. It's a protective device. It's an instrument. So from the standpoint of the dominant, it's an instrument of closure and control and subordination. So Christians with Jews in the European city, whites with blacks in the American Fordist metropolis. But from the standpoint of Jews in the European cities, from the standpoint of blacks in the Fordist city, it is also a shield that creates a separate sphere that allows them to accumulate cultural capital, symbolic capital, to organize, and to eventually, in a sense, challenge the negative visions of that population, to invert the valence of the symbolic capital attached to them. In a sense, the movement to black, to black is beautiful, in a sense, and to mobilize and to eventually overturn the form of ethno-racial domination that uses space as an instrument to define and confine them. And I say this, so this is what I call in a future book that you couldn't announce because it's not on my webpage. It's called The Two Faces of the Ghetto. And in The Two Faces of the Ghetto, I make the argument that ghettos have been seen, you know, as these sort of negative things, that you don't want ghettos, they're bad, of course, you know, from a moral standpoint, yes, they violate the fundamental principles of equality of all and so on and so forth. But from a sociological standpoint, because of this sort of moralizing view of the ghetto and this sort of prosecutorial approach that most social scientists have taken to the emergence and rise and fall of the ghetto, what they have failed to understand is that a ghetto is a two-sided contraption that is an instrument of domination and subordination, but also a fabulous instrument of protection. And it's an instrument of self-organization and mobilization and power for the group that is ghettoized. And this is why, in a sense, ghettos are structurally unstable formations that have sort of a limited shelf life, because they produce the conditions of their own undermining. Whereas formations that emerge that entrap and confine, or in which dishonored and dispossessed populations, the marginal, are entrapped, which do not have the qualities of the ghetto, can in some ways, particularly for purposes of the creation of a collective identity and mobilization, and the fight against discrimination, for instance, can actually be more deleterious, because they do not create the shared collective identity and the collective capacity for action that a ghetto does. And so the protective function of the ghetto gives us a key to understand the dynamics of the fights in the city over ethno-racial domination. And so it's important to, in a sense, see the positive side of ghettoization, the paradoxical positive side of ghettoization for the subordinate category. But now I can leave this side of the diagram. I'm going to erase this and then return us very quickly to, see how much time do I have. I borrowed a watch that is so complicated to interpret. It has five quadrants and five. So I think I have, 10 minutes?
Sure.
15
if you're
no. So let me walk you through this diagram and see. So what happened to the Black American ghetto? Now, if you understand what a ghetto is, and it's not simply a space of segregation, it's not simply a place of despair or a violent place or so on, but it is this peculiar socio-spatial contraption, then you can track the collapse, the implosion, the collapse onto itself of the Black American ghetto after the 1960s for three reasons. One is economic. It's a shift from a Fordist industrial economy centered on the city that needed unskilled labor power in large pools. And the ghetto was a perfect instrument to bring black labor from the South, have it predominantly in the northern industrial city, and have that pool of labor and practice that economic extraction. But roughly speaking, after the 1970s, that unskilled black labor concentrated in the central city is no longer needed. And that function of economic extraction of the classical ghetto disappears. And so, in a sense, the first element of what is a hyper-ghetto, it's a ghetto that has lost its function of economic extraction. But as it loses its function of economic extraction, it also loses the income, and it loses, in a sense, the class formation that accreted around that stable employment. And so what it does, it loses a second characteristic of the ghetto. It loses the buffer of protective institutions run by the group and for the group that characterizes what I call, in a sense, the communal ghetto. And these institutions, these communal institutions held by the stigmatized category, for the stigmatized category, providing a framework for everyday life, becomes replaced by the social control institutions of the state. You know, welfare turning into workfare, public schools reduced to the level of custodial institutions because they lead nowhere and simply hold the youth outside of the street for most of the day. And of course, the unleashing of the police, the courts, and the prison system, and the parole agent, who become, in a sense, the face of the state inside of the hyper-ghetto. So your hyper-ghetto has, instead of simply segregation by race, has double segregation by race and class, because the black middle class not simply leaves the traditional ghetto, but so why does the ghetto collapse? I mentioned economic factor, that's one. Second factor is the great white migration, and we're still waiting for the American scholar, courageous enough to write after many, many, many books about the great black migration from the South to the northern city, to write a book about the Great White Migration, the millions of whites who migrated from the central city as blacks came in, to recreate in the suburbs the social and spatial distance with the undesirable population now moving into the cities. And so why is the Great White Migration to the suburb important? Because it transfers the center of electoral gravity of the country from the central cities to the suburbs. And 1968 is the last election in which the Democratic Party, the supposedly progressive party, has to win the cities. After that, it can simply win the suburbs. It doesn't have to care for the city. So what does this do? It marginalizes the urban marginal population in the economic sphere. So economic marginalization, political marginalization. Third factor, importantly, so economic transformation, political transformation, the civil rights movement, transmuting into the Black Power movement, challenging frontally the continued socio-spatial seclusion of African Americans in the American metropolis. And of course, the three factors lead to the implosion of the ghetto, the collapse of the ghetto into itself. The outmigration of whites create the, in a sense, the vacancy chains, the space needed for the black middle class to grow in the peripheral, in the neighborhoods adjacent to the ghetto, inside the city, but separate from the traditional historic heart of the black belt. And so what you see is you see a social and spatial dispersion, separation of the black community that continues to be segregated, but no longer ghettoized, but rather contained and confined. Now, if you wish, the socio-spatial seclusion of African-Americans today proceeds through the articulation of two formations, the hyper-ghetto for the marginal fractions of the working class and the sub-proletariat, and segregated satellite neighborhoods that are physically and socially separate from the hyper-ghetto. So now, if you want to understand this dynamic, then you can see that this dynamic here I have summarized. Now, when you go to Western Europe, and I'm going to go very quickly because I really don't have the time to. What you observe to start with is a working class territory, which is a very different socio-spatial configuration, characterized in particular by the very tight integration of the life of work, the life of the local state, the municipality, and the life of the neighborhood and the family sphere. And typically across Europe, and you see it very dramatically in France in the so-called Red Belt around Paris or around the large industrial cities, so-called Red Belt because it was held by the Communist Party, in a sort of power-sharing arrangement with the right-wing parties that held the central state, because the right-wing party expelled people from the center of the city, in an agreement with the Communist Party that the working class expelled from the central city would be relocated in these peripheral neighborhoods and would, in a sense, build the power basis of the Communist Party. And so a tight integration between the life on the factory floor, the life in the domestic sphere in the neighborhood, and the local municipal state. This, in a sense, becomes undone. This becomes undone through deindustrialization, through the rise of unemployment, through the rise of precarious employment, and through the shift in particular in state policies of housing, which should concern architects and urban planners first and foremost, in the following sense, is that Western European states by and large cease to provide support for building housing for the lower classes and increasingly provide help, housing support to households and not buildings. And what this does is that it gives middle class households the capacity to capture that individualized support for housing, to migrate outside of the social housing sector into privatized housing tracts. And this basically creams off the middle class and the lower middle class outside of the public housing building, leaving behind only the working class at a time when the working class is seeing its unemployment rate rise dramatically, in a sense, setting off a dramatic process of pauperization of those territory. In a sense, the unhinging of the framework that where you had a coherence between Fordist stable wage work, the nuclear family, rigid age relationships, tight integration between the world of work, trade unions, which were run by the same party as the party that was running the municipality and providing programs for the kids outside of school, providing programs in school, and then where you had a sort of direct reproduction of the working class when daddy and mommy would bring their daughter and their son to the same factories in which they work, and you had direct process of class reproduction. Now this becomes all an inch, throw in the school system in the middle, where now even to access low-level jobs, you need to have finished secondary school, you know, which wasn't the case for the previous generation, and you have a process of gradual erosion, decomposition of these working class territories. Now, and the question then arises, are these working class territory being eroded, being transformed, and being, quote, ghettoized? And this is where, having spent a little time doing a sort of a rigorous analytic characterization of what a ghetto is, gives us some purchase. Because if we haven't characterized analytically by what we mean by ghetto, then the question, are the poor neighbors of the French banlieue, are they becoming ghettos? Well, if you don't know what you mean by ghetto, the question is, in a sense, either meaningless or unanswerable. If you stay with the folk perception, with the ordinary, everyday category of the ghetto as a bad neighborhood, a segregated neighborhood, a violent neighborhood, a neighborhood where you have dilapidated housing, then you, in a sense, you can find ghettos almost everywhere. But you know what? If those are ghettos, then the Jewish ghetto of Renaissance Florence or Rome or Venice was not a ghetto. And if the ghetto is a territory simply of dilapidation, of crime, of violence, or so, then the Black American ghetto also wasn't a ghetto. A ghetto is not a territory of segregation, of dilapidation. It is this urban condom that seeks to fulfill these two functions, that combines these four elements, stigma, constraint, spatial confinement, institutional parallelism. So now, using that schema, we can return and answer that question. Have the working class territory of Western Europe emerge in the direction of the ghetto? And I answer in the negative, and I'll send you, of course, to the book to look at the details, the empirical details of that. But let me just highlight four dimensions. If you have a process of ghettoization, it means that you have a process whereby socio-spatial seclusion in the city is operating. And so you are corralling members of a particular population to live in a space that is reserved for them, which means two things. If a particular neighborhood is being ghettoized, this neighborhood should show rising ethnic homogeneity. Okay? So let's look at ethnic homogeneity. Well, if we look at the neighborhoods, and in this case I studied empirically, I carried out field work on the south side of Chicago for the Black American ghetto, and I carried out field work in the Red Belt city of La Courneuve in the northern, northeastern industrial suburb of Paris, for those of you who've taken the plane and landed at Charles de Gaulle Airport. When you take the RER, the rapid transit train to go to the center of Paris, you can wave to your left, you see the big housing project of La Courneuve in this nondescript, highly urbanized landscape, highly deindustrialized. And then La Courneuve is sort of the archetype of the Red Belt banlieue that has degraded and deteriorated and turned into, in public perception and popular language and political language, into the ghetto, the cité ghetto, the banlieue ghetto. Let's look at what has happened to the banlieue ghetto. Ethnic composition. Those neighborhoods are becoming increasingly diverse. Those neighborhoods typically have a strong presence of immigrants, but they remain majority national. And typically in the last 30 years, what you observe is that their ethnic composition is becoming more heterogeneous. So, well, if we have a process of ghettoization, we would expect more ethnic homogeneity, but we're seeing more ethnic heterogeneity. Second process is the same, in a sense, the same process, but looked at from a different statistic. Here it's how many members of the La Courneuve, what's the proportion of La Courneuve coming from one ethnic category? Okay. And here we see that, in fact, the population of La Courneuve is becoming more like an ethnic hodgepodge. In fact, I can give you, there's a simple way for me to remember it, is that when I carried out my field work in 1989, 91, you can see roughly the people living in the housing, that housing project of Les 4000, the 4,000, nicely called for the 4,000 units that composed the housing project. It was basically 26 nationalities. And it's pretty easy to remember because now it's just inverted. It's 62 nationalities. And so the second, so growing ethnic heterogeneity, but then the second statistic we want to know is, what proportion of all members of the supposed ghettoized category live in such spaces? And here what we observe is the growing dispersion. The growing dispersion of for instance, stigmatized immigrant population coming from North Africa, who were more segregated, more confined in the 1960s than they are today. So again, a movement of in the opposite direction of the ghetto. Third variable that we're going to look at, if we have a process of ghettoization, then we would observe that the stigmatized category that is constrained to live in its confined space is building institutions of its own. So we would see within that space rising organizational density. What do we see in the working class territories of Western Europe uniformly, whether it's the formerly industrial cities of Rotterdam, you know, in the Netherlands, or in the Ruhr of Germany, or in the north of Italy? What we see in the country is the emptying of organization, is the loss of organization, particularly traditionally working class organizations, but the whole gamut of associations and formal organizations in this neighborhood. So we see, in a sense, decreasing organizational density. And lastly, the ghetto has this particular virtue, if you wish, or at least has this particular property, that it is a sort of a cultural fusion machine that takes the various strands of the stigmatized categories that have, in the case of Jews, different national provenances and different languages and different versions of the religion that united them together, but also in the case of African Americans, different regional identities and also different skin color and a different will to be identified differently across those skin gradation. People have forgotten that until the 1920s, the United States Census even identified mulattoes, quadroons, octoroons, and so on as intermediate categories between black and white. So what the ghetto does is that it takes these, in a sense, culturally disparate populations, and it acts as a sort of a cauldron, a cultural fusion machine that will create a unified collective identity out of the disparate experiences of the migration streams of the population coming into it. And so the Jewish ghetto created a unified Jewish identity out of the Ashkenazi and Sephardic currents of the Jewish population. But likewise, it created a unified Negro and then black and African American identity for African Americans in this country. It's not by happenstance that the Harlem Renaissance happens in the 1920s and 30s, right when there is the formation of the ghetto in the city. And now, when we turn to the working class territories of Western Europe, what do we see? Is we see on the incapacity now, after 30 years of politicians and journalists announcing that the ghettos have come to Western Europe, and now we have to fear the unification, the ghettoization, the segregation, the Americanization of the city. What we see after 30 years, the incapacity of creating a shared identity. And I'll give you just an example to dramatize this point. In La Courneuve, for 30 years, the residents of Les Quatre Mille have been given land by the city with an amphitheotic bail, that is free use of land for 100 years, to create a mosque. And the various currents that are of Muslim attachment have been Moroccans, Tunisians, Algerians, Turks, and now increasingly people coming from Eastern Africa and Mayotte and so on, and are incapable of agreeing to even build a mosque together. And so even the fear that Islam would provide, in a sense, a unifying category would be a shared identity that in these neighborhoods would coalesce to create now this sort of collective demanding or actually actualizing the ethnicization of European space has also failed. So we see the failure to create a collective identity. The only collective identity that is being created is through territorial stigmatization. And here, I'm gonna stop here and I'm not gonna go into. So I've refuted the convergence thesis. I've argued that the ghetto became the hyper-ghetto. The working class territory became an anti-ghetto. Why anti-ghetto? Because in a sense, these are, I would characterize them as pauperized or impoverished, stigmatized neighborhoods that if they are evolving at all in a direction that you want to compare to the ghetto, are in fact evolving away from the pattern of the ghetto. They are becoming more ethnically heterogeneous. Their boundaries are porous. Now, here's an interesting finding, is when I returned to present my book in that neighborhood that I studied, I couldn't meet any of the families that I had interviewed and that I had observed because all of them have moved out. All of them have moved out, and the majority, so far as I was able to reconstruct where they have gone and so on, have moved out because they moved up the class structure, either through schooling or through small entrepreneurship or through steady employment. A lot of them steady employment through public employment. And as they migrated up the class structure, they migrated through space and dispersed. And they didn't rise up the class structure to create a separate Arab or Maghrebin or North African or Muslim or Algerian middle class neighborhood. They separated and got individual housing and then, in a sense, dispersed. Well, here again, we can say, well, that's not if they were being held in that. A ghetto that has a porous boundary and that allows its middle class to leave is not a ghetto by definition, because the ghetto is there to contain the totality of the group. And the classic ghetto of both Jews and African Americans contained the totality of the classes. It didn't let people out on account of rising up the class structure. So what we see there is, if we want to make this comparison, in fact, we see that the working class territories are evolving away from the pattern of the ghetto. Thus, I call them anti-ghettos. Now, I want to finish with this, because I am running out of time. And I do want to have time for discussion. And I understand that there's a reception, that the martinis should not wait for us too long. Now here, let me explain then the last part of the equation. Here what we have, if we want to understand socio-spatial seclusion in the American city, we have to understand what is the mechanism that sorts populations and leads them to be relegated to that at the bottom of the system of places, at the tail end of constraints, and at the bottom of the hierarchy of neighborhoods that forms the metropolis. And here when we look at the Black American ghetto, we see that ethnicity, in this particular variant of ethnicity, that is ethnicity that pretends not to be ethnic, denegated ethnicity, ethnicity that says it is rooted in biology and not culture, that is the particular form of ethnicity that Americans call race. Ethnicity trumps class, that is you're categorized and you're thrust and you're relegated into that particular reserved territory by virtue of your race, that trumps class, and that is reinforced by the state. And here, if I had a little bit more time, if this was a three-lecture series, then we would have, in a sense, a sort of historicization of both the ghetto and the working class territory, where I would show that what distributes population in this two-by-two space is the state. And don't let anybody fool you, especially not from the Chicago School, that there's some ecological process that, as Robert Park put it, it is with humans as with plants. They migrate and find the place, you know, with human ecology in the environment that suits their needs and that results in a symbiotic division of spatial labor where everybody finds their place and everything works and the organism of the city works. No, what distributes people along these two axes largely is distribution is done from the top and from the bottom, but largely it's the state that determines. You know, and if I had a little bit more time, I would show how the ghetto itself went through three ages, the age of sort of accretion from below, the age of reconstruction from the top, and the age of penalization with the rolling out of workfare and prison fare as the contraption to handle the population remaining in the hyper-ghetto. But so the state aggravates this process of relegation in the American city, whereas here, when we move to the European case, we see that class trumps ethnicity, that the primary factor that leads to being relegated in a derelict, dispossessed, stigmatized banlieue outside of Paris or outside of Lyon or outside of my hometown in Montpellier in the south of France, you know, in the housing projects of La Payade, where, you know, everybody fears, oh, La Payade, my God, don't go to La Payade. You know, you're going to get killed. Oh, La Payade, very quiet, poor neighborhood with lots of immigrants, so what? But there's this process of territorial stigmatization that is a characteristic of the new urban marginality that leads to the belief that this is a neighborhood that's an urban hellhole where you can't go in, where the police doesn't go in, which the stigmatization of that neighborhood increases not only the burden of everyday life in there, but it has two implications. Stigmatization, territorial stigmatization becomes added, superimposed on ethnic or racial or immigrant stigmatization, and it has impacts at two levels. On the social fabric and experience of everyday life in those neighborhoods. As residents know that if you live in La Payade, you know that you're a piece of trash. Well, what they do is, in response to that, the growing spread of discourse of vilification of residents of these territories of relegation, people react with four strategies. They withdraw from the neighborhood, mutual distancing. I don't want to identify, associate with my neighbors. I use the stigma and I thrust it on them, yes. The people in La Courneuve or in La Payade are really bad. My neighbor, not me, of course, but my neighbor, yes, he's really doing drugs, he's drawing unemployment illegally, he's getting welfare, he doesn't want to work. I know people in this building don't want to work, and so on and so forth. So you have mutual distancing, what I call lateral denigration. And then you have withdrawal in the private sphere of the family. And lastly, you have exit. As soon as you have an option, the first thing you want to do is leave those neighborhoods. And what do these four strategies of adaptation to territorial stigmatization do? They weaken the social fabric and the capacity for collective action of residents of those neighborhoods. And then, so that's at the level of everyday experience. And at the level of the state, they provide latitude and warrant for the state to engage, in a sense, what are de facto special policies reserved for those neighborhoods that would be unacceptable if they were carried out in around that quadrant of space, but that typically end up further marginalizing and, I would argue, injuring the residents of those neighborhoods. For instance, the major campaign that is going on right now in Western Europe to dismantle and destroy large concentrations of public housing. There's been this notion, largely coming from America, the whole notion of neighborhood effect, that if you live in a large housing, public housing concentration, and it's now stigmatized, it's really bad, and the residents will benefit simply from being dispersed. So let's destroy the public housing. But meanwhile, where is the remedial housing? Where is it being built? And so what is going on is campaigns of large-scale destruction of concentrations of public housing that are actually hurting the residents because they are not providing the remedial housing and the social support that this classical concentration of public housing were providing. So we see here how territorial stigmatization impacts to further marginalize and to bear on the life chances and the life strategies of the emerging precariat. So here we have, but when we turn to Western Europe, what we see, class trumps ethnicity, and the process of marginalization is largely cushioned and mitigated by the action of the state. This is why I have divided by the state rather than multiplied by the state. Here, in a sense, the intensity and the duration of marginality is aggravated by two policies, the policies of urban retrenchment, the new federalism of the American state that withdraws from the cities and lets cities handle themselves, which of course they don't have the fiscal capacity to do so, and then they collapse. Or, you know, the policy of social welfare retrenchment, workfare rolling out and rolling out of prison fare. That reinforces the marginality, anchors it, hardens it, deepens it at the bottom of the socio-spatial structure. In Western Europe, you see a different movement. You see a sort of a tangle between, on the one side, the politicization, the redrawing of rights, the expansion and remaking of welfare programs and so on. And then you see an incipient penalization. But by and large, the state acts to compensate the process of relegation and to, in a sense, mitigate the four dynamics of which I won't have the time to speak of that feeds this urban marginality. Thus, to close, well, that's got to be my closing line, to finish explicating the title. There was one part in the title that I haven't explicating, designing urban marginality in the 21st century. Well, the designing is the state. And, you know, in a sense, the grand designer, by omission or by commission, the agency that, in a sense, sets the parameters within which the allocation of people and activities in this 2x2 space is determined, how fast you go down that, you know, down that hierarchy and how hard the boundaries are and how much do you circulate from here to there rather than from there to here, or whether you have a ghetto in the first place or not, or whether you have a large-scale prison system or not to welcome, in a sense, the new urban marginality. That is determined, in a sense, by the gamut of state policies. And so the designer, in a sense, the design is the state, and I would argue that urban planners and architects, without knowing it, even when they work for the private sectors, are, in a sense, accomplices or are handmaidens or are, in a sense, workers in the grand sort of construction of this space of socio-spatial relegation, where whether they built gated communities or whether they built prisons, are working with or alongside the state to shape the process whereby socio-spatial seclusion takes place in the city. Thank you. So we do have. So we do have time for questions, right?
We have time for good. Some questions.
Okay, and I'll try to answer briefly in about 1 minute each because I always have the temptation to try to sneak the last 15 minutes of the talk in the first question, and that's not going to work.
Questions? Oh. Question. I actually have tons of questions, but I'll limit myself to one. In architecture, the kind of issues about urbanism and the process of marginalization and a kind of Marxist or neo-Marxist understanding of how it is that these categories are constructed and blah, 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 come through Foucault, but also through Henri Lefebvre and somewhat through Tafuri. But so I'm curious to know whether, particularly around Lefebvre and Foucault, whether these are authors that you're your professional colleagues. Yeah. I'm just curious to know whether we've kind of exchanged in the same group.
Okay, excellent question, which allows me to sort of crack, allows me to characterize better what I try to argue. And actually, for the longer answer, there's an entire chapter, the closing theoretical, there's a theoretical coda in Punishing the Poor that addresses, in particular, the difference between the diagnosis that I pose of the penalization of poverty and a Foucauldian approach. You know, and actually, this is a way of giving you the answer. The framework that I draw in particular in that book, but also in Urban Outcasts, is from Bourdieu, you know, who was my teacher. You know, and in particular, in Punishing the Poor, I use the notion of bureaucratic space as a way to rethink the state, as an arena of struggle, within which there's a struggle between the left hand of the state, the nourishing hand, the feminine hand of social work, social housing, healthcare, education, and so on, and the right hand of the state, the ministry, the Treasury Department, the Ministry of Finance, but also the police, the courts, and the prison system. And there's a struggle between these two hands, so there's a battle inside the state to decide what treatment to give to these conditions. And so using, to point to one difference, using Bourdieu's framework allows me to, in a sense, leave open the question of what is the particular combination of these three treatments that will be applied to what population and what condition. Whereas, and so in a sense, and I argue against Foucault, for instance, that there is no overall logic of panopticism that is sort of taking over and mandating. So first, in a sense, what is happening is not inevitable, is not a necessary sort of coming of, you know, modernity, biopower, and what have you. Rather, there were historical paths that were taken because the balance of power led to, in a sense, accentuating penalization and eliminating or downplaying medicalization and socialization. And where this is important is that it leads, for instance, with three or four important differences with Foucault's diagnosis, is that the rolling out of the penal state does not proceed capillary style, as, you know, with this image that Foucault has in Discipline and Punish, with the webs of discipline are in a sense being dispersed throughout the social body and are capturing, in a sense, the whole society. I argue with, on the contrary, it's a highly targeted phenomenon. The penal state is being rolled out along a very steep gradient of class, ethnicity, and place. And it is highly selective. And not only is it highly selective, and it's rolled out essentially in and around the hyper-ghetto. And this is why the prison population of the United States has become black after 1973. In an era where, contrary to common perception, crime has become whiter during that period. So not only has crime not increased, it stagnated and then decreased. So you can't explain why you're getting a massive penal state. But crime has become whiter. If you take a photograph of the cohorts of criminals arrested through the years between 1973 and 2003, that cohort is becoming whiter. The proportion of whites is increasing, the proportion of blacks is decreasing. So you should have seen a whitening of your prison population. And you don't. Why? Because the rolling out of the penal state was highly selective by class and by race. And how could it be highly selective by class and race? Because it was selective by place. And so, in a sense, having a more differentiated version of how, you know, the rolling out of the penal apparatus comes out, different from Foucault, you know, allows you to explain that phenomenon that Foucault can't explain. Also, the big problem that this development presents for Foucault is that Foucault, when he writes in 1975, is heralding the end of the prison. He writes that as the disciplines are coming out of the prison, the carceral is now this form that is dispersing through the social body, it's in its other institutions, and the prison, he writes, and I'm quoting exactly, loses its raison d'être. You know, and everybody thought in 1975 the prison was an obsolete institution that was about to sort of, you know, go into the dustbin of history. And the reality is that when he writes, France has 33,000 inmates, and today France has 75,000 inmates.
Just think, is at the risk of provoking the third lecture, I think I'm going to pick on two little points that interest me. One's a point of clarification. I assume when you talk about the state, you include in that sort of massive formation banks, the real estate industry. Okay. Because I would have thought that one of the huge underlying differences in the material that you're comparing are patterns of land ownership.
Okay.
And certainly in the American case, which I know best, there have been, you know, massive changes that are very characteristic of who owns property in the inner city, where they live, and how the banks deal with that. So that's one interest I have that I think probably conditions some of the differences. The other point is a little bitty point, but it's very local for us here in New Haven, and that is that I know from this and a few other cases a lot of stories that probably qualify the porosity of the borders of ethnic clusters in the 19th century. Mm-hmm. What your surname was a very readily identifiable characteristic in Italian neighborhoods and Polish neighborhoods. Uh-huh. And if you look at an early social reformer like Jacob Riis, you see he's absolutely, as a Northern European Aryan, absolutely obsessed with both the physical and the presumptively cultural characteristics of these immigrants and the inhabitants of the ethnic clusters. And certainly in little old New Haven, the degree of porosity, say for the Italians who came over to work in the factories in the 19th century, was pretty limited for a long time, and that porosity increased dramatically at a certain point, thanks in part to the state. And the fact that those immigrants organized, as you rightly described, and took over a lot of the political institutions. So those are my thoughts.
Let me respond briefly. On the state, I would not include the real estate industry in the state, but I would include the real estate industry in what, following Bourdieu, and hopefully this will be an occasion for people to go and read a little bit of Bourdieu, which I think would be useful for urban planners, is the field of power is in a sense, is that represented, you know, you could have like sort of an ovoid formation in which you have in the middle of the states, the bureaucratic field, and then on the right-hand side, the holders of economic capital, of which the banks, the real estate industry, and so on would be players. And then on the left-hand side, you have the holders of cultural capital, science, religion, academics, intellectuals, and so on and so forth. And so within, and so why, so Bourdieu characterizes the field of power of that space within which the various holders of the different forms of capital, economic capital, specified as real estate capital, financial capital, industrial capital, but on the other side, symbolic capital specified as juridical capital, scientific capital, artistic capital, and so on. The various forms of capital compete with each other to determine the relative supremacy and preeminence of the different species of power. And in a sense, and this is set, of course, by the conversion rate. You know, can you purchase a degree? How much can you get out of your degree? And so on and so forth. So I would, in that space, I would put the real estate in the field of power, but not inside of the state. And in particular, not so in the United States, where precisely one of the characteristics is the large autonomy. It's internationally is the large autonomy of the real estate industry from the holders of power, or one would even argue the extraordinary power of the real estate industry to influence the local government. And so the United States in that regard has two distinctive properties compared to Western Europe broadly, is that it's a highly differentiated and even fragmented bureaucratic field with multiplicities of level that work at loggerheads and don't collaborate with each other, and particularly the federal government, state, county, and city. And then, so that's one dimension. And then the rest is the enormous power historically wielded by economic capital, especially at the level of the local state. The distinctive feature of Western European countries is the greater bureaucratic unification, the greater capacity to have, in a sense, land use policies on a national level, imposed including in every municipality, the greater autonomy and power of the bureaucratic field relative to the economic field, but also, very importantly, and in a sense, it's the translation of the same property, the greater intervention or activity of the state as a provider of housing. And of course, a major distinction when you go across the Atlantic is that in the United States, public housing is housing reserved for the most destitute, and that provides 1 to 3% of the housing stock. And when you go to Western Europe, public housing is in fact housing that historically has provided housing from the bottom to roughly the middle sections of society, and that provides anywhere between 35 to 55% of the housing stock. And so, of course, the state has immediately an ability to determine, in a sense, access to housing in ways that in the US it does not have. Now, lastly, on the ethnic cluster, I'm not sure that I made myself clear that the ethnic cluster, the boundaries of the ethnic clusters are porous. And so, yes, they are, in a sense, the initial wave of migrants.
But in a sense, but the porosity increases or decreases over time, especially with the capacity to capture the local states. And the porosity of boundaries, as soon as immigrants, in a sense, mobilize enough, and there's enough of a concentration, and they use their vote as muscle to actually make the boundaries very porous. But now, if you go back, and I don't know about New Haven, but I know I've read very well, I'm very well read up on the Italian-American community in Chicago. What's interesting is that in the classical historiography of immigrants, Italian immigrants in Chicago, there is the representation that they were this, and because of the influence of the Chicago school that confounded the two socio-spatial types and represented as, in a sense, similarly segregated, similarly isolated. The reality is the recent historiography has found that what were represented as Italian ghettos were actually overwhelmingly non-Italian populations, even at the height of Little Italy, was 45% Italian and 55% non-Italians. And also, more importantly, what total proportion of all persons of Italian origin were contained within Little Italy? Less than 20%, meaning 80% of the Italian immigrants of Chicago at the height of Little Italy lived outside of Little Italy, contrasted to the Black American ghetto during the same period in 1930, where the Black American ghetto is 95% Black, and the 5% are really the people at the margins. And, but more importantly, the other statistic, 75% of all African Americans live within that containment zone. And you provided part of the answer to your question in the last part, which is what determines the fanning out and accelerated the porosity and the dispersion of the group is the policies of the state, particularly the New Deal, but also the GI Bill, and of course the big highway transportation networks that in fact were racially skewed and allowed the European immigrant streams to fan out through American social space, rise up in the class structure, and disperse through space, and then kept African Americans hemmed in. And I think in New Haven, I don't have to mention the horror of urban renewal and the construction of highways as ways of buffering cities to protect them from the invasion of Blacks coming from the South and so on and so forth. So I would still make, but in a sense, it's a matter of degree. In a sense, here we create these oppositions. You could see this as a sort of polar opposition, or if I had a fourth lecture, I would do. You could actually set up a continuum.
You can set up a continuum,
and you can show how the same population in a given city experiences urban conditions that is closer to the type of the ghetto, but migrates towards the type of the ethnic cluster, or vice versa, migrates in the other direction. I'll take three, four short questions and try to answer them together.
Short answers.
No, one answer.
Oh, okay.
Hi, I'm just wondering whether, curious about your thought on the recently that the French government revealed a plan for an outer belt public transportation that is designed by Mr. Posenberg. And what do you think about the sociological implication of this? Project in?
You mean in Paris, the greater Paris
yes,
project?
Yes.
And next question. Three
distinct questions. Okay. Your socio-spatial model of urban structure presumes a lot of spatial knowledge on the part of everyday people. I've somehow internalized various cities in terms of the structures you've outlined. And so my question is, the media for this urban knowledge, how that gets disseminated in it seems a variety of different ways.
While I found your triad of stigma, constraints, and spatial confinement very compelling, I'm wondering about the fourth structure element and the degree to which you find it actually structural. Knowing that it's very rare and also really difficult to have true legal independence, I guess, at the institutional level for cultural communities, and also that those cases are riddled with contradictions about violation of rights in different cases, what do you mean by institution, and to what extent is that institutional sort of parallelism necessary to having a ghetto?
Okay. Okay, well, I'm going to try to weave an answer that
Now, the Paris transportation ring, that's going to be hard to bring that into one seamless answer. So let me actually deal with that first. I think it's not clear that this project will get off the ground at all. Right now there's no financing, and it's part of Sarkozy to find a sort of distracting element, and in particular to reassert the power of the right over the region. And so it's more of a political maneuver. I know that, of course, among architects, it's like this grandiose project. And I read the article in the New York Times that said, oh, in Western Europe, the cities have these great, whereas in the US there are no great projects and so on. But what it misses is that it is really a political maneuver by Sarkozy to try to impose a new administrative structure and retake power over the region, the greater of the Île-de-France, which they have lost to the left. And so it's not clear what's going to happen to it, but if it does happen, and if you now have this sort of new ring of transportation, I think it's going to reinforce the existing concentration of capital, of all forms inside of Paris. It's going to increase the attraction of Paris and deplete the outer regions. And the whole question becomes, to me, in a sense, it continues to create deep-seated inequalities within even this public transportation. In my book, Urban Outcasts, I argue that one of the five public goods that every state should provide on a free basis is transportation. And if you really want to deal with urban marginality frontally, you ought to provide education, housing, lifelong training, health care, and transportation on a free basis, through income grants and through mileage grants, in particular to remedy what is a really enormous obstacle for people at the margins of society finding jobs when jobs are available is the time and money that it takes to cross physical space to go to those jobs. Whereas if you had an account in miles, in a sense, that would be given universally to everybody. Some people would use it to go spend the spring vacation in Switzerland, and other people would use it to go around and find jobs. So I would be more interested in Sarkozy had proposed something along those lines than something about the transportation web that he claims to want to build. Then the knowledge about how to maneuver the cities, and how to know where your place is and so on and so forth. There's a multiplicity of mechanisms that, of course, and the best way to study that is actually study how when migrants come into the city, how they learn. Well, the networks of friends and kin who are already there, who clue them in, who tell them what's a place for them, what's not a place for them, where they're supposed to go, not go, where the boundaries, for the people like us lie, and so on. So that's one. So they learn from their kin, from within their own group, if you wish. But they also learn through official institutions. They also learn through the violence when they try to purchase housing outside of the reserved perimeter, and they find that their house is firebombed. They learn from that. Or they find out when they always get taken, when they are from a particular subpopulation of the American citizenry, and they are taken always to the same neighborhood where only the likes of them reside. Well, in a sense, the real estate agents tell them, teach them what they are supposed to know about their place in the city. So there's a variety of agencies that teach people. Of course, one very important one, which brings us to the penal state, is the police that teaches you, what the boundary. When I lived, was a graduate student at the University of Chicago, I was given the last apartment, the last student apartment unit on campus when I landed there coming from the South Pacific, because I had applied and sent my letter from Noumea, New Caledonia. It got lost on a ferry boat somewhere going to Chicago. So when I landed there, they hadn't received my applications. There was no housing. I was on the street, I was a homeless student. And so they gave me the last unit, the one that no one wanted. Why did nobody want this unit? Because it was right on the edge of the ghetto. Technically, it was in Woodlawn, it was not in Hyde Park. And so I lived there, so now how, as a French person, how did I learn what the rules? Well, the first thing I was given on campus by the very nice secretary of the sociology department, it's a little map of Hyde Park where, and I use this verb advisedly, she blacked out those areas where I wasn't supposed to walk. She said, never go north of 47th Street, and then never go west of College Grove, and never go south of 61st, south of 60th Street. My apartment was on 61st Street. So of course, well, being French and being contrarian and so on and so forth, the French, this is how your relation to authority is. If you're told something, then to not do something, then do it. And of course, the first thing I did my week is to go and visit, go west of College Grove and north of 47th Street.
and stuff of 61st Street. So, but you learn, you are taught by the natives who know how to use space, or you are taught by looking how the built environment is configured. For instance, there was the last white telephone, properly white telephone, that in a sense marked the boundary of Hyde Park where the private police force of the University of Chicago patrolled. So I was right there on the boundary, which actually meant that it was very safe because it was patrolled all the time. And so my friends who said, oh, you're going to move from where you are because it'll be unlivable and so on, they got burglarized 20 times in the heart of Hyde Park, and I never had any trouble because I was right there where the police was patrolling all the time. And so then, well, you know, when I ask people, you know, and then you learn, you know, for instance, I was the only person who was walking out of the front of the building because the front of the building was facing 61st Street and Woodlawn. The back door of the building was facing Hyde Park, so everybody came in and out of the back building. I was the only one, you know, to come out of the front of the building. But, you know, so then you ask and you observe, and so you learn gradually. And, of course, you watch the 8 o'clock news, and the 8 o'clock news for me, the 6 o'clock news, of course, in the U.S., but translated to French, it means it's the 8 o'clock news. I will always remember in my head Floyd Calbert, the announcer of Eyewitness News at 7 p.m., you know, say, "Have a safe evening, Chicago." What is this teaching you? You know, is the city is an unsafe environment? Why is it unsafe? Why do you need in a sense, you learn, in a sense, the cultural tools that tell you how to navigate this diagram. In a sense, you learn them gradually. And in some ways, I mean, at the beginning of Urban Outcast, I say that one of the shocks that led me to write the book, because when I landed in New Caledonia, my dissertation topic, I think you're going to laugh. I arrived at the University of Chicago, and I already published and done a bit of research in the South Pacific, because I had done my military service for the French state as a sociologist in New Caledonia, a small French colony island in the South Pacific. And so I arrived in Chicago with my dissertation topic was the making and unmaking of the colonial society of New Caledonia. You know, when I end up working on the Black American ghetto. So, and one of the reasons I did it, you know, and I tell that story in the book is because of the shock for me of having to learn precisely how do Americans negotiate this, you know, this race and class and space boundary on a day to day. And so for me, it was like a daily puzzle. I mean, a puzzle, practical puzzle. I had to figure out, well, when you go into a building to buy, you know, to buy a used furniture, as I did when I arrived as a student, I didn't have money, so I bought everything secondhand and so on. You go into a building and you notice as you cross the street, there are no more University of Chicago police people, you're the only white person, and when you enter the building, that every door inside the building has burglar bars. Then, you know, you kind of pick up that, you know, you're no longer in Hyde Park. You know, and this is a different neighborhood and things are going on here and so on and so forth. So it did challenge me on that level, but also it challenged me in a moral, I mean, for me, morally. I mean, it was a deeply disturbing experience. And so, in a sense, for me, studying the fate of the Black American ghetto was a way of grappling, you know, with that experience and sort of making analytical sense of an existential conundrum. And then the last question is the fourth level of ghettoization I wrote down. What was the last question, if you could just remind me just in one line? The fourth level. Yeah, the fourth, why, in a sense, would it be enough, is it not enough to just have, in a sense, stigma, spatial confinement, okay? Stigma, constraints, spatial confinement, and what do we mean by institutional parallelism? An institution, you know, an organization that serves the needs of the people who use it, you know, or a particular enduring pattern of social action, you know, but, or concretely, your own stores, your own churches, your own religious, you know, organizations, your own places of learning, your own, you know. So, and what you observe, both in the case of Jews in the Renaissance city in Europe, is that they develop their own commercial institutions, their own places of learning, their own places of worship, their own forms of collective and mutual support, you know, mutual association society, burial societies, stores, you know, professional practices, political forms of organization, and so on. And what is really striking is that you have the exact same thing. Even the Judenrat, you know, in the German ghettos of the 18th century, for instance, you had a council, a political council that existed inside of the Jewish ghetto that provided political representation with to the whole city of the Jewish population living in. So the Judenrat organized its own affairs internally, and you know, even meted out justice and so on and so forth, and took, in a sense, took over the functions of the state, if you wish, inside of its reserved territory, but was then accountable to the authorities of the city outside. Now, remarkably, it's a little known fact, a little studied fact. I'm always trying to get somebody not in this, not in an architecture school, more in a history department, to do a dissertation on this, is that in black metropolis in Chicago in the 1930s and 40s, there was an election, a mock election, of the mayor of Bronzeville, of the mayor of the black city within the city, who was elected by an election carried out by whom? By the two major black newspapers. Again, you ask what's a parallel institution? A black newspapers that provides black news for black readers. And the Chicago Bee and the Chicago Defender together got together and organized a mock election of the mayor of Bronzeville, which was taken a mock for the outsiders, but not mock at all for the insiders. It was a very popular event. And they elected, in a sense, the parallel mayor of the parallel city, who was then the official representative of Bronzeville, not only with the city hall, with the actual city of, you know, the actual mayor of the city, but also with foreign dignitaries. And when the mayor of Chicago would receive foreign ambassadors and ministers visiting and so on, and they would take them to visit Bronzeville, they would, in a sense, have a ceremony where they would meet officially with the mayor of Bronzeville, elected by the Chicago Bee and the Chicago Defender. So here, in a sense, we have a particular example. Now, what you are saying is that, well, but isn't that a very restrictive condition? That if you put this fourth property of the ghetto, then in a sense, very few groups qualify. And I would agree, yes. And I think the ghetto is a relatively, historically, a rare configuration. And in a sense, in its folk ordinary usage of goes for a bad neighborhood or a segregated neighborhood, yeah, there have been tons of ghettos, you know. But in this sociological sense, there's been very few. I'll mention four, just so that you know there's not only two. The black American, the Jewish ghetto of Renaissance Europe until, you know, the coming of the French Revolution in the late 19th century, roughly. The black American ghetto from a very limited period. Blacks prior to the 1915-20 period were not ghettoized in American cities. They were segregated, but they were not ghettoized. And that's, you know, in a sense, and that's a different configuration. From the 1920s to the 1960s or 70s, I would argue, the burakumin, the so-called invisible race, the outcast category in Japan, coming from the Tokugawa period, the descendants of the Eta, a stigmatized outcast group associated with all the occupations that are considered filthy and degrading in the Shinto religion. Eta meaning, just to give you a sense of how stigmatized the group is, Eta is typically translated as filth eternal. Now, I think that when you have that name as a group, you know that you are stigmatized. You know? And so they were originally stigmatized in separate hamlets. So this is where we go back to this map. See, there was, in a sense, you could put the hamlet of the Burakumin. They lived in separate hamlets where they were not allowed to come into the city. They were basically holding all the occupations having to do with blood, with flesh, and with the body, with dead bodies, cadavers, meat, leather, and so on and so forth. And so they were not allowed to come into the city. They were forced to reside outside. They were forced to wear different garb. They were supposed to kneel down or to plunge on the ground when they met a non-Burakumin. They had specific names that allowed people to identify them and so on and so forth. When, after they were emancipated in 1871, discrimination was supposedly ended, but when they migrated into the cities, they were corralled in separate neighborhoods. And here the spatial, the stigma and constraint and spatial confinement led to the creation of parallel institutions again. And so the Burakumin, Buraku meaning hamlet, the people of the hamlet, became urban dwellers. They were no longer in hamlets, but they lived in a ghetto. And then the fourth case is the Gypsies or the Romani or the Sinti and Roma of Eastern Europe. And I would make one exception. This is why my book is a comparison of the US with Western Europe. If you took Europe more broadly, I would argue that there is one population that remains ghettoized to this day and it's the Sinti or the Romani or the Sinti and Roma. Again, you use the exonym or the andonym, you know, so on and so forth. That's the whole question of, you know, but Romani is probably the more neutral term. And particularly in a country like Bulgaria, for instance, you know, where they have remained distinct spatially and linguistically and thrust at the bottom not only of the socio-occupational hierarchy, but at the bottom of the system of place, and largely segregated in territories that are maintained as such with parallel separate institutions provided by the state, but separate schools provided for Romani children in their Romani neighborhoods, keeping them, keeping in a sense their life sphere, you know, and paradoxically, which explains their ability to mobilize at the supranational level, at the European, and there's now a lot of activities to fight the discrimination of the Romani, you know, in Eastern Europe. And paradoxically, I think being ghettoized has given them a platform of, in a sense, an organizational framework to work from, whereas I think the paradox of postcolonial migrants in countries like France or the Netherlands or Germany or Italy, when they are not ghettoized, is in fact they have not benefited, if you wish, from the organizational and the symbolic unification that ghettoization provides. And so even to, like, you know, what are they, you know, they don't even have like a name or, you know, or an identity. They don't exist as a collectivity, you know, and so they mobilize under, you know, a variety of organizations, names. You have, you know, the Le Cran, the Representative Council of Black Associations that wants to mobilize, you know, against discrimination. But is it discrimination or is it segregation? Is it only for black people or is it all for other people? Is it for foreign black people or for native black people? You really don't know. Then the North Africans can't identify because it's an organization that calls itself, you know, the Black Association. We're not black, and so on and so forth. So the paradox of the dispersion and the lack of ghettoization is that, in fact, African Americans, I mean, it's controversial to say this because it seems like you become a supporter of ghettoization. No, but the historical record should actually, you know, African Americans benefited from ghettoization insofar as it allowed them to mobilize and challenge frontally the system that they were facing. Whereas, for instance, Afro-Brazilians or persons, you know, darker skinned Brazilians in Brazil find themselves to where, well, they are dispersed along a gradation of color, and it's never clear whether the discrimination they suffer is a class discrimination or a color discrimination, and they don't identify. And then so the efforts by academics and intellectuals to create a black movement, in a sense, is not helped at all by the fact that the group was not unified and compacted in one territory where it had shared institutions and shared means of representations and a shared symbolic system that was made possible by the ghetto. So there's a paradox, in a sense, that the ghetto is a more brutal form of domination, but it sows the seeds of its own overturning, whereas more modest forms of ethno-racial domination are harder to confront frontally. And I think I'm about to be confronted. So So I said I would not have a PowerPoint presentation, but I think this was better, right?
Thank you for two lectures. Please join our speaker on the second floor in the architecture gallery for refreshment and further conversation.